When you think about dinosaur media from times in and around the 90s, your mind probably goes directly to things like Jurassic Park or maybe the Land Before Time movies. You might even remember the television show about the Sinclair family or all of the video games that were jam-packed with dinosaur action that were everywhere that you looked back then. What probably doesn't come flooding back though is a little game that marries two very different genres in a beautiful way for something completely unexpected on the Game Boy Color. While it's fleeting to find a genre mashup that feels great to play, Dinosaurus managed to reach a great balance of challenging exploration-centric platforming and turn-based battles that draw heavily on traditional RPG elements. The premise of this game is mostly non-existent, with the allure here being able to control six different types of dinosaurs and raise them from babies to adulthood, all the while taking on the dangers of the Cretaceous wild. The game opens with you seeing the birth of the first little one, an iguanodon, that you're free to name whatever you like. While the goal isn't immediately obvious, a quick press of the start button will reveal an overview of all of the different terrains that you'll eventually have to visit. The world is interconnected, with each of the regions running together as one continuous map, but you won't be able to reach them all in the early stages of the game. There are either physical barricades, jumps just out of reach, or bodies of water blocking the way, and these are opened up slowly as you bring new dinos onto your team. The one place to work toward is always marked by a red X that represents a boss encounter that you have to complete before moving on. The entire game unfolds this way. You get a new dinosaur after defeating each major boss, and a new contender appears in a brand new territory to explore. It's a pretty simple formula, but it's what you do along the way there that will determine whether or not you have what it takes to challenge your next opponent and win. Roaming around in Dinosaurus took some getting accustomed to. Each of the six dinosaurs are totally distinct in how they control, with different walking speeds, jumping heights, or special abilities like being able to swim or fly. Even though platforming is at the very core of the adventure, depending on which dinosaur you're playing as, it can range from relatively easy to absolutely unforgiving. The dinosaurs with large jumping distances can gain a lot of height to get you to out-of-reach places above you, but hopping horizontally can quickly turn blind when the screen inevitably scrolls up and the target moves out of sight. I died a lot from misjudging platform distances, and about 90% of the time, if you fall down through the bottom of the screen, you're dead. This seems harsh in a game with an experience system where you'd be forced to load an earlier save point and lose any progress that was made, but the game conveniently autosaves every time you move to a new screen. The only time I ever did lose significant progress was when I did a lot of grinding in one spot and forgot to transition between screens once in a while, but this was never an issue just getting around from place to place. If you think that platforming accuracy for stationary targets seems difficult, wait until you see what moving targets have in store. One place in particular that comes to mind is at the volcano, where you need to cross its mouth with your Velociraptor to get to the boss fight on the other side. Of the three dinosaurs that you have at that point, the Velociraptor is the only one that can land on these tiny platforms, since the other two just fall through them. The first time I played this game, it took me at least an hour of repeatedly trying to get through. The platforms are so small, and when you jump, they disappear from view, so you're guessing where you need to land. There isn't a lot of adjusting that can be done once you're in the air either, and if you don't land in the exact middle of each one, you're gonna take an eternal snooze in the lava below, and as cute as that looks, it's a real blood boiler. This was hands down the cruelest place in the whole game for platforming, since there are also lava splashes that not only stop you dead in your tracks and make you miss your target, but slowly eat away at your health right before you're supposed to take on a boss. There's a single golden mushroom to eat to restore some health on the way, but it's nowhere near the end of what's just a ridiculously long section that will have drained all of your dignity by the time you finally make it across. We haven't even touched on the battle system yet, but as I mentioned earlier, it's traditional turn-based RPG fare with dino-on-dino action. Battles are random encounters that pop up while you're trying not to plummet to your doom, and at a quick glance, you might be thinking that this battle screen and how it's organized looks pretty familiar. Dinosaurus is often compared to Pokemon because of this, but apart from the combat screen visuals, nothing else is even remotely similar. For example, you can't switch between members of your dinosaur team in combat, so whoever you start the fight with also has to finish it. Another difference is that there are no healing items to use, but while traversing the different environments, you can eat health-restoring fruits, mushrooms, plants, or other small critters you come across. It's no surprise that there's no shop to buy any dinosaur snacks or other restorative items that you'd see in fantasy-themed RPGs. One of my favorite parts about combat was watching each dino thrash around like it was hearing its favorite music when the random encounter would occur. The pterodactyl definitely rocked out the hardest of the bunch, and seeing him get whisked away into battle midair never got old. Since leveling up in Dinosaurus is restricted to experience gained after winning battles, not being able to switch between team members during encounters also means that they have to be leveled up individually. This isn't a terrible thing, since exploring will shove you into a ton of fights along the way, especially with the very high encounter rate here. Enemies that you fight conveniently scale their level with yours, so when you're checking out an area with a newborn level 1 dinosaur, you're not going to get roasted every 5 seconds. While advancing in levels will cause physical attacks to become stronger and stronger, it unfortunately never changes a dinosaur's moveset, and the physical attacks available to use remain the same regardless of the level. If you start out with claws and bite, that's what you have to work with for the whole game. It would have been neat to see some kind of change or growth in that respect as each dinosaur got stronger, but it lacking didn't really take away from the game either. In addition to physical attacks, all 6 dinosaurs can harness the power of 4 elements. At a glance, it might look like the same old tired thing that you'd find in any other game with a magic system, but it's not. While magic point totals increase as a dinosaur levels up, gaining experience doesn't directly translate into learning new spells to cast, and the spells can't be found or bought either. Instead, they're locked behind a mechanic that entails collecting element icons that are scattered all over the place in the platforming areas. Each dinosaur can accumulate up to 15 of one element type, and for every 5 of the same kind collected, a new spell opens up and can be used in battle. It's totally worth it to spend the time tracking these down, especially late in the game when they become crucial to winning or losing. Even the level 1 spells pack a hefty punch, but unfortunately for your crew, all random encounter dinosaurs can also cast magic at you, and there's no doubt that you'll die from many an earthquake and fireball attack throughout your adventure. Bringing down bosses feels totally different because there's a big disparity between these and regular fights. While normal enemies fall easily after being attacked with low-level spells, these won't even phase the 6 ferocious beasts that stand in your way, and physical attacks are also out of the question. Much of the strategy of winning a boss fight relies on big magic casts and lots of luck, like who gets the first turn and how many times the boss misses you. Grinding up until you could get a few good rounds of top-tier magic out before getting annihilated was the most reliable strategy, but even then, things didn't always work out how you'd hope they would if the survival gods didn't smile down upon you. On top of all this, there's a huge sticking point that I would like to mention here that ground my game to a permanent halt. It's this. Some bosses can't ever be beaten even if you grind up to the maximum level and exploit the elemental weaknesses. I learned this lesson in the hardest way possible. The first time I played through, I gathered elements sporadically while I was investigating each new area. If I walked past one with a dinosaur, I grabbed it and I didn't think twice about it. What I didn't realize is that these are finite, and they don't respawn. What's more is that, as I mentioned earlier, only specific dinosaurs can reach elements in places like the sky or the water, so if you pick up ones on the ground with the Plesiosaurus or the Pteranodon, the other ground dinosaurs will never be able to find enough to reach max level, and they'll consequently never be able to cast level 3 spells. So in case you're wondering, yeah, I soft-locked myself out of being able to win the game by playing it casually. By the time I got to the final boss without maxed elements for my 6th and final dinosaur, and realized that I couldn't even take off a sliver of health from the boss with any of the attacks or spells that I had, it was far too late to do anything about it. You might be curious as to why I didn't just switch to a different dinosaur with maxed out levels for the final boss, but the game doesn't let you fight with just any dino. Each fight has to be won with the new baby that was born at the beginning of that section, so I had to play the whole game over again and plan which dinosaurs I used to pick up which elements, making sure to fully explore the sky and water bodies with ones that had specific access to those places, and crossed all of my relevant appendages that I'd have enough left over for my Compsognathus to unleash his fury. The ending was totally worth playing through twice, but the crushing realization of a soft lock did sour my opinion of the game as a whole, since there was absolutely no warning that it could happen. What a terrible design flaw. I would have gladly consulted an online guide, but as of the time of this video, there are none to read through, nor was there a manual scan available either. On the bright side, getting through Dinosaurus multiple times only further solidified my love for the graphics and the really quirky soundtrack. The cutscenes when each of the dinosaurs were born, as well as the interludes when you're introduced to a boss, were fantastic, and coupled with the music, the ambience here was incredibly unique. The music is not even close to what you'd expect from a dinosaur game, but the excellent sprite work for the enemies more than reminds you what kind of game you're playing. The six dinosaur characters were very cute and expressive, with a wide range of animations for eating, idling, and sleeping, apart from all of their action movements while platforming. Just look at how cute they are when you rest them at a nest. I loved these little details so much. Dinosaurus is the kind of experience that every kid and adult that was swept up by games like Pokemon or Metal Walker at the time should have clamored to get their hands on, but unfortunately this game never made it out of the PAL region to North America, and many people never got a chance to play it. It's a total mystery as to why, especially since there are even link cable battle capabilities that would have hung it even higher among the greats of the time. Even though this game flew mostly under the radar, and while it isn't perfect in some aspects, it does make for a fresh take on turn-based RPG mechanics and the trials of a platforming game. It's definitely worth having a closer look at if you're hoping for something offbeat from either of these genres.